On behalf of the organizing committee, we would like to welcome all of participants, distinguished guests to Airlangga International Conference on Economics and Business 2018.
Welcome to Surabaya. Welcome to City of Heroes. Welcome to City of Culinary. And also welcome to Airlangga International Conference on Economic and Business.
I hope all of you have abundant opportunities to discuss. I expect fruitful discussion would take place during this conference. I hope your discussion will be both productive and enjoyable.
The next 5 to 10 years will be a very crucial time for Indonesian economy. So if we do our homework, we do like comprehensive reforms needed, we can become a high income country in the next 2 decades.
Today, we are all a year in an era of disruption era.
Industrial revolution, so-called 4.0, it become another challenge for us.
So we are a Surabaya-based group with approximately 15,000 employees. So indirectly, we support more than 45,000 of people with their economics.
Now, disruption is a recent concept. It was a concept that was identified by a Harvard professor in 1995.
So let me go first next to describe a little bit about why Indonesia have a 5% growth comparing to before we got a much higher growth.
Sit down,
thank you to all speakers for sharing on this topic of disruption era, household, government and business response. And also thank you to all parties for supporting this international conference. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good morning. The Honorable of Dean of Faculty of Economics and Business, Airlangga University, the honorable of professors and lecturers of Airlangga University and university from all around Indonesia, the honorable speakers, distinguished guests, and all participants of the 2018 Airlangga International Conference on Economics and Business. First of all, on behalf of Bappenas, I would like to express our highest appreciations to the Airlangga University for conducting a very excellent international conference on a topic that really relevant to the current economic situations. For your information, right now Bappenas is currently in the process of preparing the next 5 years development plan 2020-2024. So I believe that the conference will provide great inputs to us, especially to improve the quality of our development plan. So ladies and gentlemen, so in our view, the next 5 to 10 years will be a very crucial time for Indonesian economy. So if we do our homework, we do like comprehensive reforms needed, we can become a high income country in the next 2 decades. However, if we do nothing, we will be stuck at what we call the middle income trap. So this is why I choose the title of my presentation, Indonesia's Medium Term Economic Challenge. It's part of our preparation for the national development plan for the next 5 years, setting the stage to become high-income countries. Sorry. I hope it's not that too small, but You can look at this chart. That the chart shows the long trend of economic growth of Indonesia, and we can see that the economic growth has been declining. So before the Asian crisis, we can grow beyond like 7%. But after the Asian crisis, right now we only grow by 5.3%. And for the past 5 years, we can grow only at about like around 5%. Sorry. Ini di mana? Mohon maaf. Ini di bisa di next? Yeah. So in Bappenas, we did some simulation for next 5 years. So if we look at the left chart, this is the baseline scenario. If we do nothing, so the Indonesian economic growth will get worse. It will go below 5% based on our estimations. At the right chart, it's like the best scenario. If we want to become a high income countries by the next 2 decades, so we need to grow by 6%, close to 6%. So now we grow by only 5%, but we need like to grow by 6% to become a country. There's a gap between 5% and 6% that we need to fill in that with reforms. However, this task to increase economic growth will not be easy, since we need to overcome challenges globally and also in domestics. In the case of global challenges, the world economic and trade growth is forecasted to be relatively flat for the next 5 years, as you can see in the left chart. There is also a problem of trade war that could lower the economic growth and the trade volume for the next 5 years. This is an analysis from the Oxford Economics that shows that the negative impact of trade war to the US economy and China economy. In Indonesia, as a small open economy, we still rely on the world economic growth and trade volume growth. If the condition of the world is improving, then we can go also improving, and vice versa. Next. The other challenge is the monetary policy normalization in the advanced countries. As you know that throughout the 2018, there is an increase in Fed fund rate that created capital outflows in emerging market economies. Next. Which led to currency depreciations across emerging economies that includes Indonesia. Like year to date, rupiah has been depreciated more than 10% to USD. Next, and also create drop in the equity market indices. And Indonesia stock exchange is one of the stock market that got hit quite deep by this monetary normalization in the US. Now, the problem is the pressure will not end soon. So the Fed is still planning to increase their Fed fund rate 3 or 4 more in the next years. So I think the pressure to rupiah will still happen for the next years. Next. Nah. This is also the next challenge that we have to face as also the topic of this conference. The next challenge is the digitalization and industrial revolution 4.0. While this disruption could increase productivity and efficiency in the production process and also bring ease and convenience to customer, at the same time there is also potential job loss, especially for the unskilled labor. Next. So this is some estimates on the number of jobs placed based on sector and occupation due to automation. So around the world there's gonna be like 52.6 million job loss that predicted due to automations. And mainly the occupation that will be lost is like manual worker. So we have to anticipate this also going forward. Next. Ladies and gentlemen, not only global challenges. To increase economic growth, we also need to address the domestic challenges. One of the biggest challenges that we think we need to cope is the low productivity. If you look at, I hope this is too small, Indonesia is the red dot here. So in the Indonesia productivity level is relatively low compared to the peer countries. And if you can see here, this is the total productivity growth from 1980. After the Asian crisis, Indonesia is the green line. We grow like the lowest compared to the peer countries like Vietnam, China, Thailand, or Philippines. Next. Now, one of the biggest reasons why we have a low productivity, especially because we have a very low productivity in agriculture and service sectors. Next. Due to the what we call unideal structural transformations. If we look at our agriculture share to GDP, it has been declining, but compared to other countries, still high. Our share agriculture to GDP is around 13% of GDP, but especially if we look at the share of labor in the agriculture sectors, we still have like more than 30% labor working in agriculture sectors. So this is the biggest reason why the productivity in the agriculture sector is very low. Next. And also the problem of a possible premature industrializations. If we look at of industry share to GDP, it's actually still very high compared to other countries. If you look at here, Indonesia is still above other countries in terms of share of manufacturing, above 20%, around 20% of GDP. But if we compare to Thailand and Malaysia, this is the development of industrial manufacturing share to GDP. The manufacturing industry in Indonesia fell too early compared to Thailand and Malaysia. If you look at the red line is like Thailand, the blue line is Malaysia. The manufacturing industry share fell after they reached 30% of GDP, and it came after they reached a very high income per capita compared to Indonesia. But Indonesia, we still at this level of income per capita, but the manufacturing industry already fell. We haven't reached the 30% of GDP, but we're already experiencing declining of manufacturing sectors. Next. As a result, if we look at our exports, this is from 1985 to 2016, about 30 years. So in 1985, we export crude petroleum, right? And then we still export petroleum. This is also petroleum, but now we also still petroleum and palm oil and coal. The blue color is electronics. Actually, after 1985 to 1995, we export more electronics. But from 1995 to 2005 and now, basically the export of electronics is not increasing by much. Basically, it's stagnant. I will compare this to China. Next. This is China. In 1985, they also export commodities a lot. But in 1995, they already changed the industry, the manufacturing sector, moved to textile. Also in 2005. And in 2005 and 2016, they export more electronics. So you can see there's a structural transformation from happened in China. From commodities, textile, and then go to electronics sectors. Now they export more electronics. Next. And this is also Malaysia. Malaysia start with the same with Indonesia, they export a lot of commodities, rubbers at that time in 1985, but now you can see more blue colors in their exports since 1995, 25, and 2016. A lot of blue colors, showing that they export a lot of more electronics than the commodities. Next. And this is Thailand. Thailand also is the same. In 1985, they still export commodities, the yellow blue, the yellow color, but after that, 30 years from now, they already start export electronics. A lot of blue color in Thailand. Next, and if we compare to Vietnam, so Vietnam until 2005, they still dominated. Their reports still dominated by the commodities, the yellow color. But you can see in 2005, they already moved to textile industry, the blue relatively blue color, and 2016. They have a lot of electronics export in 2016, this one. So for 30 years, we're still exporting commodities, but other countries already doing structural transformations. They export more on electronics as not rely on commodities anymore. Next. This is the same story. This is the manufacturing export share to total export. Indonesia is the lowest here compared to peer countries, compared to Vietnam, China, Thailand, and Philippines, even to Vietnam. And then it's the high-tech export. So manufacturing that has the high technology, again, we are the lowest, and Vietnam already passed us in around 2010. So next. because we still rely on the commodities, so our export is still quite very low compared to other countries. It's also affecting macroeconomic stability. The pressure of rupiah that we felt for the last past years is also happened because there is a widening current account deficit, right? Widening current deficit is because we don't have enough exports, basically. If we compare it before the Asian crisis, actually the current account deficit is improving. But if we compare to other countries like Thailand and Malaysia, they have surplus and we still have like a deficit, current account deficit. And simply the reason is because we don't export a lot compared to them. They export more than Indonesia. Next. Nah, in Bappenas we did what we called a growth diagnostic. We try to find the main constraints behind the economic growth. So in our diagnosis, the reason behind the problematic structural transformation is we do not have enough quality investments. We call it quality of investment. And I will show you at least three indicators for this. This is the first one. In the left chart, this is the infrastructure stock in Indonesia. This one is before the crisis, 41%, 49%. And then this is 2012. So you can see that our infrastructure stock is lower after the crisis, before in the order era. So it means that we do not invest enough to replace the infrastructure that has been depreciating. So, and you, as you can see here, the reason is low investment for infrastructures. We have a very high investment to GDP ratio compared to other countries, but mostly goes to like construction investment. We built a lot of mall, we built a lot of apartment, we have built a lot of housings, but investment that goes to infrastructure is relatively low and has been declining. So that is the reason why the infrastructure stock is lower compared to the before Asian crisis. Next. And the low quality of investment can also be seen from the investment in machine and equipment. This is the chart. We compare the accumulation of investment in machine equipment between peer countries. We have Malaysia, Mexico, Philippines, Thailand, and South Africa for 2007 to 2016. As we can see, Indonesia, in terms of GDP, the accumulation of investment in machinery and equipment is one of the lowest in compared to these countries. So we know that for industry to be able to grow, to be able to expand, they need to invest in machinery and equipment, but it's not happening in Indonesia. And then this is also one of the indicators that show that we lack of quality of investments, which is the FDI. Compared to other countries, we have a very low foreign direct investments. Why we think that FDI is important? Because if there is a lot of FDI, it means that there is going to be a lot of transfer of technology, transfers of know-how. But this is not happening in Indonesia. So we have a low quality of investment in terms of infrastructure, FDI, and also machinery and equipment. Next, the third quality of investment is also human capital investment. So human capital investment is still lacking also in Indonesia. This is the chart. In this chart, we compare again the secondary and tertiary school attainment with the whole country in the world. Indonesia, again, the red dots. I hope you can see it. This is Indonesia, secondary attainment. And this is the tertiary attainments. Compared to other countries with the same level of income, we are still below. This is in terms of quantity of education. Next. And this is in terms of the quality of education. This is the PISA score and TIM score. As you can see here, Indonesia, the red one. Our score in PISA and TIM is also still way below the average of the OECD countries. So we are lacking in terms of quantity of education and also the quality of education. Next. And as a result, if you look at the structure of our employment is still dominated by unskilled workers in every sectors, agriculture, manufacture, and also services and others. Next. This is what worries me the most. I'm going to talk about the health side of the human capital, right? Human capital is not only about education, but also about health. If you look at here, Indonesia still have a lot of problem in stunting and underweight. Indonesia here, we still above the other countries in terms of problem of stunting and underweight, children below 5. Next. And this is the immunization rate. You can see that immunization rate, this is for measles and hepatitis. Indonesia is way below other countries. And next, this is the case of tuberculosis. We have the highest case in the world. And what interesting, this is smoking prevalence for male. The other country experience declining smoking prevalences, but Indonesia is increasing. So we're talking about disruption era. We're talking about digitalizations. We're talking about automations. The question is, how can we compete in this era of disruptions if our people are less smart and sick more often compared to our competitors? This is why human capital, I think, is one of the important part that we need to address. We still need to invest more on education and health, especially if we want to compete in the era of disruptions. Next. So, but ladies and gentlemen, the part that I have shown you is like the gloomy side of our economy. But however, I believe that we have reasons to be optimistic. So as you can see, although the economic growth has been stuck at around 5%, if we look at our recent economic growth, it's actually trending up despite various challenges that we're facing. And this is economic growth for the last 5 years. Economic growth continued to improve, rebounding from the lowest point in 2015. We reached 4.9, and the last quarter of 2018, our economic growth is becoming 5.3%. And the good news is, it was supported by the strengthening of investment, and especially investment in machinery and equipment. So as you can see here, for the last 4 to 5 quarters, our investment rate is quite high, more than around 7%. Next. And the improvement was mainly driven by structural reform that has been done by the government for the past 4 to 5 years. So we can see this is infrastructure development and improvement of the investment climate. Previously, I showed you that there is a declining infrastructure stock, but increased infrastructure investment that carried out in recent years has been able to reverse declining in the infrastructure stock. So ladies and gentlemen, you can see the infrastructure stock is now going back up again after has been declining for the last maybe 10 to 15 years. This is one reason to be optimistic, because the impact of infrastructure investment, we cannot see it right now, but it's going to be happen in the next two or three years. And also the goodness also happened in the improvement of investment climate. The improvement can be seen from the improvement in ease of doing business ranking, which has increased significantly in the last 2 years. So previously we are like ranked 91, but right now we are more than 100, but right now we are in rank of 72. And I think the government is planning, we want to pursue like higher rank into like 40 for the ease of doing business rank. Next. Now, in terms of the era of digitalization and industrial revolution 4.0, we in Bappenas believe that they will provide net benefit instead of net loss. So as we can see here, the development of digital economy in Indonesia has been rapid. We are one of the most internet users in the world, and then it's rapidly increasing, the internet users. And not only benefiting the consumers, but as we can see here, the impact of internet use also benefiting the SMEs in Indonesia. Next. And this is the impact of Industrial 4.0. So yeah, based on some estimates that we did in the government, if we do the Industrial Revolution 4.0 correctly, it can increase the GDP and create more jobs. Our calculations shows that by moving our industry to Industry 4.0, it can increase the GDP growth by 1 to 2% compared to the baselines. And also, it will create employment creation into more than 10 million for the next 10 5 to 10 years until 2030. Next. But this is what we did for the next medium term plan. So we did some scenarios, the baseline scenario that I show you. If we do nothing, the average of economic growth will be only 4.9% for the next 5 years. But if we do continue structural reforms, we can go beyond 5%, 5.4, 5.7, or even 6, but this is the high scenario. But we need to invest in human capital, and we need to increase the investment rate by improving the investment climate, and we also need to increase the productivity growth by at least 50% to boost the economic growth. Next. We need to do the structural reform, especially to that focus on reviving the manufacturing sector. As I saw you before, that we need to fix the structural transformation in Indonesia, focusing especially on export by overcoming constraints to economic growth. Some of the countries that we identified that we still have problem in overlapping regulation and hindering bureaucracy. We still have a problem in low quality of human capital and labor productivity, inadequate infrastructure, low financial intermediation and shallow financial market, low tax revenue, and also the quality of government spending, and also in effective innovation system. Next. Now, going forward, for the next medium-term plan, the government major plans are to continue infrastructure development, especially focusing on connectivity and energy to boost the manufacturing sector. We also gonna focus on human capital investment, especially to boost the labor productivity and overcome the labor market mismatch. And then we also need to continue our investment, improvement in investment and business climate through regulatory and bureaucratic reform, fiscal reform to mobilize revenue and improve the quality of government spending, financial sector development, and also we need to develop new state of growth and tourism and digital economy. Ladies and gentlemen, to close my presentations, I would like to remind us one thing. National policy that I have mentioned to you is not enough. So we also need regional development policy. As you can see here, like Indonesia is a very huge country, like, and we have a very huge regional diversity. We have Jakarta. The level of income is the same with Poland, a high income country. But we also have NTT, or we have Jambi. The level of income is the same as Sri Lanka. So we have province that's same level of the poor country, but we also have Jakarta, that the same level of high income country. Next, and this is the, when we talk about industrialization process, so we have a province that has more than 40% of industrial share, but we have also province that only have 2% of industry, manufacturing sector in terms of their GDP. So we need to have a different approach for this province, for these regions. So we cannot have a one fit for all policy, national policy, but we need to develop a regional development policy. Next. And this is also, we have, if we compare what we export between regions, it varies differently. Like Sumatra still exporting a lot of CPO. This is Papua and Maluku. Papua and Maluku is also commodities. Bali, NTT, Java, we have a lot of electronics here. So we have a lot of diversity between regions. So not only having a good national policy is important, but we need to have a good regional development policy. I know that there is today we have a lot of faculties from different universities from all around Indonesia. So I think you can all contribute how we can develop a good regional development policy that focusing on the strength of each provinces. I think that's all for me. Thank you for your attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good morning.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. The Honorable Ibu Dekan, or Bapak Faisdin, Bapak Rudi, the Honorable my teacher, Professor Budi Resorsdarmo, the Honorable all of presenter here from Bappenas, from Kementerian Keuangan, from University, and dear ladies and gentlemen, all of you, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity given to us to be PPT. Okay. Thank you for opportunity given to us to be PPT as one of the speaker in this Airlangga International Conference on Business and Economics. On economics and business. Today we are all in here in an era of disruption era. In which the economy shift from one habit to the another habit. In this era, in the past, we stand offside a route, we wait for taxi, but now we only in front of our home, we wait for online car to pick us to another place. In the past, maybe people with his or her newspaper in city bus, but now we don't see the event again because of all of news, political news, economic news, sport, we can save in gadget, in smartphone. So we all know in the cheap economies. Only one gadget we can communication, we can write news, we can get a camera, we can get GPS and other. So it is the cheap economy in the disrupting or disruption economies. Ladies and gentlemen, according to Craigun and Sweetman, there are five causes of disruption. The first is technology, especially information technology, like I mentioned before. The second is new theory of management, like the theory of human resource, theory of production, etc. The third is economic event, like formation of European Union. The fourth is global competitiveness, and the fifth is geopolitics. However, ladies and gentlemen, in this time, I only speak the first one, the technology, especially information technology. Because in this decade, the technology, the cause of technology and disruption economies is the main cause of disruption in Indonesia. I speak about economy and then about technology in the information technology. In the economy, we have three indicator: growth, employment, and value added, or other indicator like income, and will be discussed. Will be discussed in this speech. In this disruption era, there are three sector category. First is sector whose nominal value is remainly or relatively fixed, but some subsector reduce and some other increase. The second sector is sector whose nominal value is increased, like the information and communication sector or information and communication technology in Indonesia. The third sector is sectors whose nominal value is decreased, but this decrease not decrease, but shifting from the formal sector to the informal sector, such as transportation, the taxi, Bluebird is the formal taxi, but now we take the other transportation. Online car is the informal sector. No one know that the car is a unit of business. No one know. So we will discuss about the ICT in Indonesia. Next. This is the sectors with the highest growth in 2016 and 2017. The ICT sector is the sector with the highest growth in these 2 years. In 2016, the ICT sector, information and communication sector, in the number two. But in year 2017, the ICT sector in number one of the highest growth in Indonesia, where the growth reached 9.81%.
This is it. So information and communication sector shows high performance and growth. This is the machine of disruption in this decade in Indonesia. This is the ICT subsector and multipliers in the economy. There is input-output approach or input-output analysis to know the multipliers effect of sector, multiplier effects of a sector that give impact to the other sector or the all sector in economy. There are 13 subsector in the ICT sectors, and BPPT have calculated the multiplier effect of these 13 sector. This means that there are output multiplier, labor multiplier, income multiplier, and value added multiplier. Value added multiplier represented the GDP or gross domestic product multiplier. It means that this subsector increasing in this subsector by one unit can increasing the value added of all economy by 2.91 unit. Okay. Then we in BPPT calculate the through this multiplier, we can calculate or projected in the future what should be in the future of economy if let's say ICT sector increase. Next, the projection is this is the GDP, national GDP of Indonesia in 2017, and this is the projection in 2018. This projection is in business as usual, not very optimist, but not pessimist too. This is national GDP about 13 trillion, and ICT in the GDP only 515 billion, or equivalent of 3.8% of national GDP. We use the multiplier in the table below, above, that GDP growth, we assume 5.1%, which Badan Perencanaan Pembangunan Nasional or Bappenas projection that GDP growth in 2018 is among 5 to 5.4%, but 5.4%. But Bank Indonesia projected that growth is 5 to 5.4%. In this case, we assume that growth is 5.1%, because 1 year before the growth is 5.07%. Then ICT growth 10%, because in 1 year before or in 2015 the growth is 9.8%. With this growth, we can calculate the value of the growth in billion rupiah. With multiplier effect, we can calculate that ICT growth plus effect of multiplier will be reached 95 billion. So almost twice of ICT growth itself. So share ICT growth plus multiplier to GDP growth is 13.81%. We can compare this percentage and this percentage. ICT GDP almost 4% of the national GDP, but its share 13.6% to growth of the growth of GDP. So in I mentioned before that the ICT sector is the machine of the disruption economy in this decade in Indonesia. Next, maybe. Now we say the technology. Technology, the indicator of growth of technology, is total factor productivity, or TFP, where this is the method of solo, or some people call the solo residual. Oh. The total factor productivity of Indonesia, we can next. This is the total factor productivity of Indonesia. The red line and the blue line is GDP growth in Indonesia. It seems that TFP grow and economic grow on parallel. TFP and economic growth here or have the same business cycle. We classifying the business, this business cycle, in sequence. Oil boom era, this is oil boom era, this is recession era, this is the deregulation era, this is crisis era in 1998 or 1997, and then this is the economic revival era. Now, what about TFP of ICT? Next, now, this is TFP of ICT. ICT TFP is almost similar with TFP of Indonesia overall. ICT, the red line, and Indonesia, the blue line. ICT, in business cycle, in this business cycle, similar to business cycle of TFP and business cycle of economic growth of Indonesia. So from the economy and technology perspective explained before, we can conclude that the disruption era occur in the good business cycle. Or in the business cycle, and okay, the policy implication of this next, we can conduct the policy implication in short term and in long term. In short term, regulation is needed to disruption era, especially to information and communication. So the new sector become the formal sector, not of informal sector again, and make many startup company. And the long term is strengthen education, research, of and technology to economic growth of Indonesia in the long term. This is overall. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.